Speakers, publishers, consultants, coaches, and info marketers unite. The Speaking of Wealth Show is your roadmap to success and significance. Learn the latest tools, technologies, and tactics to get more bookings, sell more products, and attract more clients. If you're looking to increase your direct response sales, create a big-time personal brand, and become the go-to guru, the Speaking of Wealth Show is for you. Here's your host, Jason Hartman.
It is my pleasure to welcome a guy that I have been following for a long time, and it is none other than Randy Gage. He is the author of 14 books translated into 25 languages, including New York Times bestsellers, Risky is the New Safe, and Direct Selling Success, Mad Genius, and many others. We're going to focus mainly on his latest book today, which is entitled Radical Rebirth. Kill off the old you and create a new life. Randy, welcome. How are you?
Hey, Jason. Great to be on with you.
It's good to have you. And you are my neighbor to the south. You're in Miami. I'm in Palm Beach. So it's great to talk to you. And I've been following your work for decades, really, and you're very prolific, have really just done so many things. Tell us about your latest and greatest and, reinventing oneself. How do we do it? Why is it important?
To me, I think there are, of course, millions of people who have no desire to recreate themselves. They are like, okay, keep your head below the cubicle, get through the week, hump day, thank God it's Friday. Okay, I get a 12-pack and I can veg out with Netflix all weekend. I can't do anything for those people. But right. I believe there are many more people who feel, hey, life should be an adventure. There should be purpose in my life. There should be meaning. I want to be healthy. I want to be happy. I want to be prosperous. And I think for those people, people like you and the kind of drive that you have, the success that you have, people like me, I believe it's all about renewal, rebirth, reinventing ourselves. And this new book, Radical Rebirth, that I wrote is kind of the outgrowth of that. I think my friends would joke and say, well, it looks like Randy's on his fourth midlife crisis.
That's the way it should be.
They joke like, do you think you got it right this time? And my response is, well, I hope not, because I hope I have another four or five of these midlife crisis.
Mm-hmm. Couldn't agree with you more. You know, so many people are just stuck in this rut and they're sort of living like the same year over and over again. I mean, think about it. We just celebrated the new year, right? And it should be like a new year, a new adventure, a chance for renewal, reinvention. So couldn't agree with you more.
Yeah, to me, it's about how do we keep moving toward the highest possible version of ourself. Yeah. And that's the path to enlightenment. That's the path to wisdom. That's the path to prosperity.
Well, you know, in the real estate world, where I'm very steeped in real estate, they have a concept in the appraisal world, which is called highest and best use, right? And, you know, maybe that's how we should think of our lives, right? What is the highest and best use that we have? And if we don't do this renewal, this rebirth that you're talking about, we're just sort of becoming obsolescent, right? We got to constantly keep rebirthing ourselves.
Yeah, I love that analogy. I just love it. You think, okay, highest and best use. So yeah, if you had a store front on the Champs-Élysées, you wouldn't use it as a shipping warehouse. You'd say, wow, there's 5 million people a month walk by this storefront. Yeah. We should be selling something retail here, right?
Exactly.
It's the same, so you've got this body, this mind, these talents, this personality, these characteristics. Do we really want to spend them just spending our life on Netflix and Hulu and Disney Plus and looking for somebody to entertain us 99% of every waking moment? Or do we want to be the plot line in our own life?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Life is not a spectator sport, right? Let's talk about some of these things that you cover in the book. You know, first off, you start out by talking about how one needs to recognize that their life sucks. And I think maybe you alluded to that already a little bit and the zombie thing, but feel free to, you know, elaborate. But, you know, then you talk about, you know, why we love to hate rich people. Tell us a little bit about that and let's go through some of this content.
Let's deal with that premise you set there first, which is, does life really suck? Because not everybody watching and listening, that's true, right? In my case, I found that my early radical rebirths were because my life sucked, right? For people who don't know my story, I was in jail at 15 years old for armed robbery.
Wow.
And when you're sitting in jail at 15 waiting to go to trial, life pretty much sucks. For my rebirth was recognizing, hey, I don't want to be this person any longer. I have to kill off the old you. Uh-huh. And I had business failures and I had a business seized by the IRS and auctioned off for taxes, right? And getting to that point, I realized I'm sick, I'm broke, I'm miserable. I hate myself. I hate my life. I need to kill off that old version of me. And so the first couple were like that. And I'm sure there's people watching right now, listening, who that's the case, that they really do need to kill it off. And then there's other people that are going to be more like my later rebirths, where I wasn't running away from something I hated, but I was running toward something that I desired. Mm-hmm. And that's the level I think we all want to get to, where we are happy, we are healthy, we're living a good life. The concept I talk about in the book is divine discontent, meaning you can still live in gratitude. Mm-hmm. You can be grateful for what you've got, and you can also desire to do, have, and become more. Mm-hmm. So that's the sweet spot that I think, because you don't want hedonism where it's just, I'm never satisfied. I always got to have more. I need more money. I need more success. I need more cars. I need more wristwatches. I need more whatever. But at the same time, I get if somebody's an ascetic and they say, I want to renounce all my property and I want to go live in a monastery somewhere and spend my days in quiet meditation. Great. If that makes you happy, I have no qualms with that. All the best to you. But I think for most people, we're going to do better in that divine discontent where we are striving to, because to have more, you have to become more.
Right.
Which, you know, just your business success, you know, it doesn't just happen. It doesn't fall in your lap. You have to grow as a person to create it.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's awesome. I mean, you cover so much in this book. It's like a whole life book. I mean, just some of the topics, of course, toxic relationships. You even talk about technology like Alexa and Siri. Oh, I can't say that too loud, Randy.
Exactly.
Because Jeff Bezos is listening to everything we say.
Yes.
And sex and sexuality and hope dope and very dead pope. You know, I mean, there's obviously way too much for this interview, but just give us the things that you really want people to know. And of course, they've got to check out the book for more.
Yeah, so I break life and prosperity into six main categories, six areas that I think we get core foundational beliefs. So like money and success would be one, sex and sexuality would be one, God and religion, health and wellness, job and career. So all those main areas, you get core beliefs. Like you mentioned one of the chapters, why you love to hate rich people. Why does that happen? Because you get programmed with that. Mm-hmm. You're programmed with mind viruses, just like a laptop gets a virus. We get them in our subconscious mind. So the most prevalent mind viruses in terms of money and success is that money is bad, rich people are evil, it's noble or spiritual to be poor, right? So if you're programmed with that, as most people are, and in the book, I mean, it'll blow your mind when I show you, because what I do is I say, okay, let's look at the programming you get. Let's look at the TV shows. So I say, it doesn't matter what generation you are, right? I start with the TV shows of Gilligan's Island, MASH, and go up to Dallas and Dynasty, right. Yeah. And take it right up to the shows right now that are on HBO right now, like Succession, mm-hmm. and Billions, mm-hmm. on Showtime. And just look at the core negative, dysfunctional beliefs that they mm-hmm. create about money and wealthy people.
Yeah.
And then I show you in operas, in plays, in movies, in books, and all of, you know, the datasphere, social media, the internet. Mm-hmm. And you realize, wow, in each of these six areas, I got programmed with limiting beliefs, mm-hmm. beliefs that hold me back or sometimes actually cause me to self-sabotage. And so once you recognize that, then you realize, okay, I have these beliefs. They don't serve me. I need to replace them with empowering beliefs. And then I think is how you remake yourself, because it really is a chain reaction. When you change your beliefs, you change your vision. When you change your vision, you change your daily habits. You change mm-hmm. your daily habits, you're going to change your life.
Right.
And yeah, so you really rebuild your life from the subconscious beliefs starting there. And it's a formula. And mm-hmm. that's how I think we reinvent ourselves in a way that empowers us and serves us.
That's a great way to look at it. I love it. I love it. You've definitely had some challenges and some huge successes as well. How would you describe yourself? Are you an author, a marketer? I mean, you do a lot of things. So I'm kind of curious where some of this content is coming from and getting that context, really.
I think at my essence, I'm a teacher, right? I love to teach stuff, but the platform I like to use is writing. You know, when I'm happiest, I'm hunched over my laptop in my lonely writer's garret, typing out my next book.
Yeah.
And kind of that was one of my rebirths was, you know, I've spoke to more than 2 million people as a professional speaker. I'm in the Speaker Hall of Fame, and I used to kind of think of myself as a speaker who wrote, and I realized, no, you know what? I really would rather be a writer
who speaks.
Yeah. And there's a qualitative difference in that. And so I'm an entrepreneur. So I built my own company, my own brand. I invest and I'm practicing the stuff I'm teaching. But ultimately, I'm kind of a prosperity coach, and I write about and teach about the principles of prosperity.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Why is prosperity important? I mean, is that the goal or is it the byproduct?
People say money doesn't buy happiness, but let's be honest, poverty doesn't buy happiness.
Couldn't agree more.
I believe true prosperity is really holistic. It's health, healthy relationships, spiritual grounding, and it does include money and material things. So this stuff of, you know, hey, a car just takes you from point A to point B. Nobody who's ever driven a Viper or a Lambo or a Bentley Continental GT would ever say such a foolish thing. And he'd say, what's the difference in a hotel room? Once you turn the lights off, they're all the same. No, that's not true.
Yeah,
I agree. You can have a oceanfront suite in Hawaii with a view of the Pacific Ocean, or you could have the view of the dumpster behind Denny's or the IHOP, right? Yeah. Because it's cheaper. But you can't say it's the same. And you can't say, even with the lights off, okay, the mattress in the Four Seasons or the Mandarin Oriental is better than the mattress in the Motel.
And don't forget about the smell and the cleanliness, too.
Exactly. And, you know? And the elevator noise through the paper-thin walls and whatever. Right. So I'm trying to show people. I'm actually doing a weekly live stream every Saturday now on prosperity, right, where I'm teaching some lesson about prosperity. And I want people to appreciate all those elements, that including the money and material things, but also the spiritual side of that and the personal side of that, because that's what true prosperity is, I believe.
Yeah, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. What about forgiveness and soul crushers? How do we do that? And should we always do it? And I'm speaking, of course, of forgiveness specifically when I say that.
Yeah, the soul crusher. I have a chapter in the book of Beware the Soul Crushers, because there are just some people that are so negative and so toxic, you either have to eliminate them from your life or you have to ration the amount of time that you spend with them. Mm-hmm. And then it's probably the second to the last chapter of the book is the one on forgiveness, because I do think that's the choke point for a lot of people. Why they don't manifest the prosperity is because they're, if you're holding vengeance in your heart, there's no place for love, right? There, you can focus on one thing. You really do have to forgive others. But the thing that I'm really pushing is the self-forgiveness, because for mm-hmm. most people, the one person they have the most difficult time forgiving is themselves.
Yeah, that's the first one, right? Is yes. To not agonize over past mistakes and beating oneself up over that, right?
You know every petty thought you've ever done. You right. know every mistake you've ever made. And then you're comparing this internal version of yourself to the external version of everyone else. Mm-hmm. And they're on TV and they're on Jimmy Kimmel Live and they talk about the good work they do and the foundation they start. And you're like, wow, they're rich and sexy and happy and healthy and they do nice things and Jimmy Kimmel likes them. And right. why can't I be like that person? You know, but that person on the inside is going through the same issue because they know every petty thought they've ever had,
right.
mistake they ever made. And so if you're going to compare yourself to your friends and what they post on Instagram, you're going to come up short 100% mm-hmm. of the time.
Yeah.
You have to recognize, okay, that ain't real.
Right. We're looking at the packaging, not what's inside the package, right? So,
right. Yeah.
Very good point. Randy, wrap this all up with any closing thoughts and give out your website. Tell people where they can find out more.
Okay, so randygage.com is kind of my Starfleet command site. And I have a podcast is on there. Blog is on there. Best place to connect with me is Twitter. That's really where I engage with people. And the website also has the Prosperity live stream link, which I'm doing every Saturday morning. And connect with me and you know, hang out on Twitter. I'm happy to share the principles of prosperity with anybody and everybody.
Excellent. Good stuff. Randy Gage, Radical Rebirth, thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thanks, Jason.
Thank you so much for listening. Please be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss any episodes. Be sure to check out the show's specific website and our general website, hartmanmedia.com, for appropriate disclaimers and terms of service. Remember that guest opinions are their own, and if you require specific legal or tax advice or advice in any other specialized area, please consult an appropriate professional. And we also very much appreciate you reviewing the show. Please go to iTunes or Stitcher Radio or whatever platform you're using and write a review for the show. We would very much appreciate that. And be sure to make it official and subscribe so you do not miss any episodes. We look forward to seeing you on the next episode.